हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, आज हम क्लास 11 केमिस्ट्री एनसीईआरटी की बुक से सम बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ केमिस्ट्री का रीडिंग करेंगे। ये एक ऑडियो बुक है रिवीजन पर्पस के लिए। अगर आप बुक्स खरीदना चाहते हैं तो लिंक मैंने डिस्क्रिप्शन में दे दिए हैं। केमिस्ट्री इज द साइंस ऑफ मॉलिक्यूल्स एंड द ट्रांसफॉर्मेशंस। इट इज द साइंस नॉट सो मच ऑफ द 100 एलिमेंट्स बट ऑफ द इनफाइनाइट वैरायटी ऑफ मॉलिक्यूल्स दैट मे बी बिल्ड फ्रॉम देम। रोल्ड हॉफमैन। Science can be viewed as a continuing human effort to systematize knowledge for describing and understanding nature. You have learned in your previous classes that we come across diverse substances present in nature and changes in them in daily life. Curd formation from milk, formation of vinegar from sugarcane juice, on keeping for prolonged time and rusting of iron are some of the examples of changes which we come across many times. For the sake of convenience, science is subdivided into various disciplines: chemistry, physics, biology, geology, etc. The branch of science that studies the preparation, properties, structure, and reactions of material substances is called chemistry. Development of chemistry. Chemistry, as we understand it today, is not a very old discipline. Chemistry was not studied for its own sake. Rather, it came up as a result of search for two interesting things. First, philosopher's stone, that is Pyrrhus, which would convert all base metals, for example iron and copper, into gold. And second, elixir of life, which would grant immortality. People in ancient India already had the knowledge of many scientific phenomena much before the advent of modern science. They applied that knowledge in various walks of life. Chemistry developed mainly in the form of alchemy and heterochemistry during 1300 to 1600 CE. Modern chemistry took shape in the 18th century Europe after a few centuries of alchemical traditions which were introduced in Europe by the Arabs. Other cultures, especially the Chinese and the Indian, had their own alchemical traditions. This included much knowledge of chemical processes and techniques. In ancient India, chemistry was called Rasayan Shastra, Ras Tantra, Ras Kriya, or Ras Vidya. It included metallurgy, medicine, manufacture of cosmetics, glass, dyes, etc. Systematic excavations at Mohenjo-daro in Sindh and Harappa in Punjab prove that the story of development of chemistry in India is very old. Archaeological findings show that baked bricks were used in construction work. It shows the mass production of pottery, which can be regarded as the earliest chemical process in which materials were mixed, molded, and subjected to heat by using fire to achieve desirable qualities. Remains of glazed pottery have been found in Mohenjo-daro. Gypsum cement has been used in the construction work. It contains lime, sand, and traces of CaCO3. That is calcium carbonate. Harappans made faience, a sort of glass which was used in ornaments. They melted and forged a variety of objects from metals such as lead, silver, gold, and copper. They improved the hardness of copper for making artifacts by using tin and arsenic. A number of glass objects were found in Muski in South India in bracket 1000 to 900 before the Common Era, and Hastinapur and Takshila in North India in bracket 1000 to 200 before the Common Era. Glass and glazes were colored by addition of coloring agents like metal oxides. Copper metallurgy in India dates back to the beginning of Chalcolithic cultures in the subcontinent. There are much archaeological evidences to support the view that technologies for extraction of copper and iron were developed indigenously. According to Rig Veda, tanning of leather and dyeing of cotton were practiced during 1000 to 400 before the Common Era. The golden glows of the black polished ware of northern India could not be replicated and is still a chemical mystery. These wares indicate the mastery with which keen temperatures could be controlled. Cotillia's Arthashastra describes the production of salt from sea. A vast number of statements and material described in the ancient Vedic literature can be shown to agree with modern scientific findings. copper utensils, iron, gold, silver ornaments, and terracotta discs and painted grey pottery have been found in many archaeological sites in North India. Shushrut Samhita explained the importance of alkalis. The Charak Samhita mentions ancient Indians who knew how to prepare sulfuric acid, nitric acid, and oxides of copper, tin, and zinc, the sulfates of copper, zinc, and iron, and the carbonates of lead and iron. Ras Upanishada describes the preparation of gunpowder mixture. Tamil texts also describe the preparation of fireworks using sulfur, charcoal, saltpeter, that is potassium nitrate, mercury, camphor, etc. Nagarjuna was a great Indian scientist. He was a reputed chemist, an alchemist, and a metallurgist. His work, Ras Ratnakar, deals with the formulation of mercury compounds. He has also discussed methods for the extraction of metals like gold, silver, tin, and copper. A book, Ras Arnava, appeared around 800 CE. It discusses the uses of various furnaces, ovens, and crucibles for different purposes. It describes methods by which metals could be identified by flame color. Chakrapani discovered mercury sulfide. The credit for inventing soap also goes to him. He used mustard oil and some alkalis as ingredients for making soap. Indians began making soaps in the 18th century CE. Oil of arenda and seeds of mahua plant and calcium carbonate were used for making soap. The paintings found on the walls of Ajanta and Ellora, which look fresh even after ages, testify to a high level of science achieved in ancient India. Varahamihir's Brihat Samhita is a sort of encyclopedia which was composed in the 6th century CE. It informs about the preparation of glutinous material to be applied on walls and roofs of houses and temples. It was prepared entirely from extracts of various plants, fruits, seeds, and barks, which were concentrated by boiling and then treated with various resins. It will be interesting to taste such materials scientifically and assess them for use. A number of classical texts like Atharvaveda in Rigveda 1000 before the Common Era mention some dye stuff. The material used were turmeric, madder, sunflower, orpiment, cochineal, and lac. Some other substances having tinting property were complicica, patanga, and jatuka. Varahamihir's Brihat Samhita gives references to perfumes and cosmetics. Recipes for hair drying were made from plants like indigo and minerals like iron powder, black iron or steel and acidic extracts of sour rice gruel. Gandha Yukti describes recipes for making scents, mouth perfumes, bath powders, incense and talcum powder. Paper was known to India in the 17th century as account of Chinese traveler Ai Singh describes. Excavations at Taxila indicate that ink was used in India from the 4th century. Colors of ink were made from chalk, red lead, and minium. It seems that the process of fermentation was well known to Indians. Vedas and Kautilya's Arthashastra mention about many types of liquors. Charak Samhita also mentions ingredients, such as wax of plants, stem, flowers, leaves, woods, cereals, fruits, and sugarcane for making asavas. The concept that matter is ultimately made of indivisible building blocks appeared in India a few centuries before the Common Era as a part of philosophical speculations. Acharya Kanda, born in 600 BCE, originally known by the name Kashyap, was the first proponent of the atomic theory. He formulated the theory of very small indivisible particles, which he named Parmanu, comparable to atoms. He authored the text Vaisheshika Sutras. According to him, all substances are aggregated form of smaller units called atoms, that is Parmanu, which are eternal, indestructible, spherical, suprasensible, and in motion in the original state. He explained that this individual entity cannot be sensed through any human organ. Kanda added that there are varieties of atoms that are as different as the different classes of substances. He said this Parmanu could form pairs of triplets, among other combinations, and unseen forces cause interaction between them. He conceptualized this theory around 2500 years before John Dalton in bracket 71766 to 1844. Charak Samhita is the oldest Ayurvedic epic of India. It describes the treatment of diseases. The concept of reduction of particle size of metals is clearly discussed in Charak Samhita. Extreme reduction of particle size is termed as nanotechnology. Charak Samhita describes the use of bhasma of metals in the treatment of ailments. Nowadays, it has been proved that bhasmas have nanoparticles of metals. After the decline of alchemy, etrochemistry reached a steady state, but it too declined due to the introduction and practice of Western medicinal system in the 20th century. During this period of stagnation, pharmaceutical industry based on Ayurveda continued to exist, but it too declined gradually. It took about 100 to 150 years for Indians to learn and adopt new techniques. During this time, foreign products poured in. As a result, indigenous traditional techniques gradually declined. Modern science appeared in Indian scene in the later part of the 19th century. By the mid-19th century, European scientists started coming to India and modern chemistry started growing. From the above discussion, you have learned that chemistry deals with the composition, structure, properties, and interaction of matter and is of much use to human beings in daily life. These aspects can be best described and understood in terms of basic constituents of matter that are atoms and molecules. That is why chemistry is also called the science of atoms and molecules. Can we see, weigh and perceive these entities? Is it possible to count the number of atoms and molecules in a given mass of matter and have a quantitative relationship between the mass and the number of these particles? We will get the answer of some of these questions in this unit. We will further describe how physical properties of matter can be quantitatively described using numerical values with suitable units. 1.1 Importance of chemistry. Chemistry plays a central role in science and is often intertwined with other branches of science. Principles of chemistry are applicable in diverse areas such as weather patterns, functioning of brain and operation of a computer, production in chemical industries, manufacturing fertilizers, alkalis, acids, salts, dyes, polymers, drugs, soaps, detergents, metals, alloys, etc., including new material. Chemistry contributes in a big way to the national economy. It also plays an important role in meeting human needs for food, healthcare products, and other material aimed at improving the quality of life. This is exemplified by the large-scale production of a variety of fertilizers, improved variety of pesticides and insecticides. Chemistry provides method for the isolation of life-saving drugs from natural sources and makes possible synthesis of such drugs. Some of these drugs are cisplatin and taxol, which are effective in cancer therapy. The drug AZT, that is azidothiamidine, is used for helping AIDS patients. Chemistry contributes to a large extent in the development and growth of a nation. With a better understanding of chemical principles, it has now become possible to design and synthesize new material having specific magnetic, electric, and optical properties. This has led to the production of superconducting ceramics, conducting polymers, optical fibers, etc. Chemistry has helped in establishing industries which manufacture utility goods like acids, alkalis, dyes, polymers, metal, etc. These industries contribute in a big way to economy to a nation and generate employment. In recent years, chemistry has helped in dealing with some of the pressing aspect of environmental degradation with a fair degree of success. Safer alternative to environmentally hazardous refrigerants like CFC, that is chlorofluorocarbons, responsible for ozone depletion in the stratosphere, have been successfully synthesized. However, many big environmental problems continue to be matters of grave concern to the chemist. One such problem is the management of the greenhouse gases like methane, carbon dioxide, etc. Understanding of biochemical processes, use of enzymes for large-scale production of chemicals, and synthesis of new exotic material are some of the intellectual challenges for the future generation of chemists. A developing country like India needs talented and creative chemists for accepting such challenges. To be a good chemist and to accept such challenges, one needs to understand the basic concepts of chemistry, which begin with the concept of matter. Let us start with the nature of matter. 1.2 Nature of matter. You are already familiar with the term matter from your earlier classes. Anything which has mass and occupies space is called matter. Everything around us, for example, book, pen, pencil, water, air, all living beings, etc. are composed of matter. You know that they have mass and they occupy space. Let us recall the characteristics of the states of matter which you learned in your previous classes. 1.2.1 States of matter. You are aware that matter can exist in three physical states, namely solid, liquid and gas. The constituent particles of matter in these three states can be represented as shown in figure 1.1. Particles are held very close to each other in solids in an orderly fashion and there is not much freedom of movement. In liquids, the particles are close to each other but they can move around. However, in gases, the particles are far apart as compared to those present in solid or liquid states and the movement is easy and fast. Because of such arrangement of particles, different states of matter exhibit the following characteristics. First, solids have definite volume and definite shape. Second, liquids have definite volume but do not have definite shape. They take the shape of the container in which they are placed. Third, gases have neither definite volume nor definite shape. They completely occupy the space in the container in which they are placed. These three states of matter are interconvertible by changing the conditions of temperature and pressure. On heating, a solid usually changes to a liquid and the liquid on further heating changes to a gas or vapor. In the reverse process, a gas on cooling liquefies to the liquid and the liquid on further cooling freezes to the solid. 1.2.2 Classification of matter. In class 11, chapter 2, you have learned that at the macroscopic or bulk level, matter can be classified as mixture or pure substance. This can be further subdivided as shown in figure 1.2. When all constituent particles of a substance are same in chemical nature, it is said to be a pure substance. A mixture contains many types of particles. A mixture contains particles of two or more pure substances which may be present in it in any ratio. Hence, their composition is variable. Pure substances forming mixture are called its components. Many of the substances present around you are mixtures. For example, sugar solution in water, air, tea, etc. are all mixtures. A mixture may be homogeneous or heterogeneous. In a homogeneous mixture, the components completely mix with each other. This means particles of components of the mixture are uniformly distributed throughout the bulk of the mixture and its composition is uniform throughout. Sugar solution and air are the examples of homogeneous mixtures. In contrast to this, in a heterogeneous mixture, the composition is not uniform throughout and sometimes different components are visible. For example, mixtures of salt and sugar, grains and pulses along with some dirt are heterogeneous mixtures. You can think of many more examples of mixtures which you come across in the daily life. It is worthwhile to mention here that the components of a mixture can be separated by using physical methods such as simple hand-picking, filtration, crystallization, distillation, etc. Pure substances have characteristics different from mixtures. Constituent particles of pure substances have fixed composition. Copper, silver, gold, water and glucose are some examples of pure substances. Glucose contains carbon, hydrogen and oxygen in a fixed ratio and its particles are of same composition. Hence, like all other pure substances, glucose has a fixed composition. Also, its constituents, carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, cannot be separated by simple physical methods. Pure substances can further be classified into elements and compounds. Particles of an element consist of only one type of atoms. These particles may exist as atoms or molecules. You may be familiar with atoms and molecules from the previous classes. However, you will be studying about them in detail in Unit 2. Sodium, copper, silver, hydrogen, oxygen, etc. are some examples of elements. Their all atoms are of one type. However, the atoms of different elements are different in nature. Some elements, such as sodium or copper, contain atoms as their constituent particles, whereas in some others, the constituent particles are molecules which are formed by two or more atoms. For example, hydrogen, nitrogen, and oxygen gases consist of molecules in which two atoms combine to give their respective molecules. This is illustrated in Figure 1.3. When two or more atoms of different elements combine together in a definite ratio, the molecule of a compound is obtained. Moreover, the constituents of a compound cannot be separated into simpler substances by physical methods. They can be separated by chemical methods. Examples of some compounds are water, ammonia, carbon dioxide, sugar, etc. The molecules of water and carbon dioxide are represented in Figure 1.4. Note that a water molecule comprises two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom. Similarly, a molecule of carbon dioxide contains two oxygen atoms combined with one carbon atom. Thus, the atoms of different elements are present in a compound in a fixed and definite ratio, and this ratio is characteristic of a particular compound. Also, the properties of a compound are different from those of its constituent elements. For example, hydrogen and oxygen are gases, whereas the compound formed by their combination, that is water, is a liquid. It is interesting to note that hydrogen burns with a pop sound and oxygen is a supporter of combustion, but water is used as a fire extinguisher. 1.3. Properties of matter and their measurement. 1.3.1. Physical and chemical properties. Every substance has unique or characteristic properties. These properties can be classified into two categories: physical properties, such as color, odor, melting point, boiling point, density, etc., and chemical properties like composition, combustibility, reactivity with acids and bases, etc. Physical properties can be measured or observed without changing the identity or the composition of the substance. The measurement or observation of chemical properties requires a chemical change to occur. Measurement of physical properties does not require occurrence of a chemical change. The examples of chemical properties are characteristic reactions of different substances. These include acidity or basicity, combustibility, etc. Chemists describe, interpret, and predict the behavior of substances on the basis of knowledge of their physical and chemical properties, which are determined by careful measurement and experimentation. In the following section, we will learn about the measurement of physical properties. 1.3.2. Measurement of physical properties. Quantitative measurement of properties is required for scientific investigation. Many properties of matter, such as length, area, volume, etc., are quantitative in nature. Any quantitative observation or measurement is represented by a number followed by units in which it is measured. For example, length of a room can be represented as 6 meter. Here 6 is the number and m denotes meter, the unit in which the length is measured. Earlier, two different systems of measurement, that is the English system and the metric system, were being used in different parts of the world. The metric system, which originated in France in late 18th century, was more convenient as it was based on the decimal system. Late need of a common standard system was felt by the scientific community. Such a system was established in 1960 and is discussed in detail below. 13.3. The International System of Units. The International System of Units was established by the 11th General Conference in Weights and Measures, in bracket CGPM, from Conference General des Poids et Measures. The CGPN is an intergovernmental treaty organization created by a diplomatic treaty known as Meter Convention, which was signed in Paris in 1875. The SI system has 7 base units and they are listed in Table 1.1. These units pertain to the 7 fundamental scientific quantities. The other physical quantities such as speed, volume, density, etc. can be derived from these quantities. Table 1.1, base physical quantities and their units. Base physical quantity, length, mass, time, electric current, thermodynamic temperature, amount of substance, and last luminous intensity. Maintaining the national standards of measurement. The system of units, including unit definitions, keeps on changing with time. Whenever the accuracy of measurement of a particular unit was enhanced substantially by adopting new principles, member nations of Meter Treaty, in brackets signed in 1875, agreed to change the formal definition of the unit. Each modern industrialized country, including India, has a National Metrology Institute, that is NMI, which maintains standards of measurements. This responsibility has been given to the National Physical Laboratory, that is NPL, New Delhi. This laboratory establishes experiments to realize the base units and derived units of measurement and maintains national standards of measurement. These standards are periodically intercompared with standards maintained at other national metrology institutes in the world, as well as those established at the International Bureau of Standards in Paris. The definitions of the SI base units are given in Table 1.2. The SI system allows the use of prefixes to indicate the multiples or submultiples of a unit. These prefixes are listed in Table 1.3. Let us now quickly go through some of the quantities which you will be often using in this book. Mass and weight. Mass of a substance is the amount of matter present in it, while weight is the force exerted by gravity on an object. The mass of a substance is constant, whereas its weight may vary from one place to another due to change in gravity. You should be careful in using these terms. The mass of a substance can be determined accurately in the laboratory by using an analytical balance. The SI unit of mass is given in Table 1.1 is kilogram. However, its fraction named as gram is used in laboratories due to the smaller amounts of chemicals used in chemical reactions. 1.3.5 volume. Volume is the amount of space occupied by a substance. It has the units of length whole cube. So in SI system, volume has units of meter cube, but again in chemistry laboratory, smaller volumes are used. Hence, volume is often denoted in centimeter raised to cube or decimeter cube units. A common unit, liter, which is not an SI unit, is used for measurement of volume of liquids. 1 liter is equals to 1000 ml. 1000 centimeter cube is equals to 1 decimeter cube. Figure 1.6 helps to visualize these relations. In the laboratory, the volume of liquids or solutions can be measured by a graduated cylinder, burette, pipette, etc. A volumetric flask is used to prepare a known volume of a solution. These measuring devices are shown in figure 1.7. 1.3.6 density. The two properties, mass and volume, discussed above are related as follows. Density is equals to mass upon volume. Density of a substance is its amount of mass per unit volume. So SI units of density can be obtained as follows. SI unit of density is equals to SI unit of mass upon SI unit of volume is equals to kg upon meter cube or kg into kg per meter cube. This unit is quite large and a chemist often expresses density in gram per centimeter cube, where mass is expressed in gram and volume is expressed in centimeter cube. Density of a substance tells us about how closely its particles are pegged. If density is more, it means particles are more closely pegged. 1.3.7 temperature. There are three common scales to measure temperature: degree Celsius, degree Fahrenheit, and Kelvin. Here, K is the SI unit. The thermometers based on these scales are shown in figure 1.8. Generally, the thermometer with Celsius scale are calibrated from 0 degree to 100 degree, where these two temperatures are the freezing point and the boiling point of water respectively. The Fahrenheit scale is represented between 32 degree to 212 degree. The temperatures on two scales are related to each other by the following relationship. Degree Fahrenheit is equals to 9 by 5 degree Celsius plus 32. The Kelvin scale is related to Celsius scale as follows. Kelvin is equals to degree Celsius plus 273.15. It is interesting to note that temperature below 0 degree Celsius, that is negative values, are possible in Celsius scale, but in Kelvin scale, negative temperature is not possible. 1.4. Uncertainty in measurement. Many a time in the study of chemistry, one has to deal with experimental data as well as theoretical calculations. There are meaningful ways to handle the numbers conveniently present the data realistically with certainty to the extent possible. These ideas are discussed below in detail. Reference standard. After defining a unit of measurement, such as the kilogram or the meter, scientists agreed on reference standards that make it possible to calibrate all measuring devices. For getting reliable measurements, all devices such as meter sticks and analytical balances have been calibrated by their manufacturers to give correct readings. However, each of these devices is standardized or calibrated against some reference. The mass standard is a kilogram since 1889. It has been defined as the mass of platinum iridium cylinder that is stored in an airtight jar at International Bureau of Weights and Measures in Sauveurs, France. Platinum iridium was chosen for this standard because it is highly resistant to chemical attack and its mass will not change for an extremely long time. Scientists are in search of a new standard for mass. This is being attempted through accurate determination of Avogadro constant. Work on this new standard focuses on ways to measure accurately the number of atoms in a well-defined mass of sample. One such method, which uses X-rays to determine the atomic density of a crystal of ultra-pure silicon, has an accuracy of about 1 part in 10^6 but has not yet been adopted to serve as a standard. There are other methods, but none of them are presently adequate to replace the platinum iridium cylinder. No doubt changes are expected within this decade. The meter was originally defined as the length between two marks on a platinum iridium bar kept at a temperature of 0 degree Celsius. In 1960, the length of the meter was defined as 1.6507 × 10^6 times the wavelength of light emitted by a krypton laser. Although this was a cumbersome number, it preserved the length of the meter at its agreed value. The meter was redefined in 1983 by CGPM as the length of paths traveled by light in vacuum during a time interval of 1/299792458 of a second. Similar to the length and the mass, there are reference standards for other physical quantities. 1.4.1 Scientific notation. As chemistry is the study of atoms and molecules, which have extremely low masses and are present in extremely large numbers, a chemist has to deal with numbers as large as 6022 and then how many times zeros are there? 23 times 0 for the molecules of 2 gram of hydrogen gas, or as small as 16 times 0 are there, then 166 gram mass of a hydrogen atom. Similarly, other constants such as Planck's constant, speed of light, charges on particles, etc. involve numbers of the above magnitude. It may look funny for a moment to write or count numbers involving so many zeros, but it offers a real challenge to do simple mathematical operations of addition, subtraction, multiplication or division with such numbers. You can write any two numbers of the above type and try any one of the operations you like to accept as a challenge, and then you will really appreciate the difficulty in handling such numbers. This problem is solved by using scientific notation for such numbers, that is exponential notation, in which any number can be represented in the form n into 10^n, where small n is an exponent having positive or negative values and capital N is a number which varies between 1.002 and 9.999 onwards. Thus, we can write 232.508 as 2.32508 into 10 raised to 2 in scientific notation. Note that while writing it, the decimal had to be moved to the left by two places, and same is the exponent of 10 in the scientific notation. Similarly, 0.00016 can be written as 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 4. Here, the decimal has to be moved four places to the right and is the exponent in the scientific notation. While performing mathematical operations on numbers expressed in scientific notations, the following points are to be kept in mind. Multiplication and division. These two operations follow the same rules, which are there for exponential numbers, that is 5.6 into 10 raised to 5 into 6.9 into 10 raised to 8 is equals to 5.6 into 6.9 into 10 raised to 5 plus 8 is equals to 5.6 into 6.9 into 10 raised to 13 is equals to 38.64 into 10 raised to 13 is equals to 3.864 into 10 raised to 14. 9.8 into 10 raised to minus 2 into 2.5 into 10 raised to minus 6 is equals to 9.8 into 2.5 into 10 raised to minus 2 plus in bracket minus 6 is equals to 9.8 into 2.5 into 10 raised to minus 2 minus 6 is equals to 24.50 into 10 raised to minus 8 is equals to 2.450 into 10 raised to minus 7. 2.7 into 10 raised to minus 3 upon 5.5 into 10 raised to minus 10 raised to 4 is equals to 2.7 divided by 5.5 into 10 raised to minus 3 minus 4 is equals to 0.4909 into 10 raised to minus 7 is equals to 4.909 into 10 raised to minus 8. Addition and subtraction. For these two operations, first the numbers are written in such a way that they have the same exponent. After that, the coefficients are added or subtracted as the case may be. Thus, for adding 6.65 into 10 raised to 4 and 8.95 into 10 raised to 3, exponent is made same for both the numbers. Thus, we get 6.65 into 10 raised to 4 plus 0.895 into 10 raised to 4. Then these numbers can be added as follows. 6.65 plus 0.895 into 10 raised to 4 is equals to 7.545 into 10 raised to 4. Similarly, the subtraction of two numbers can be done as shown below. 2.5 into 10 raised to minus 2 minus 4.8 into 10 raised to minus 3 is equals to 2.5 into 10 raised to minus 2 minus 0.48 into 10 raised to minus 2 is equals to 2.5 minus 0.48 into 10 raised to minus 2 is equals to 2.02 into 10 raised to minus 1.4.2 significant figures. Every experimental measurement has some amount of uncertainty associated with it because of limitation of measuring instrument and the skill of the person making the measurement. For example, mass of an object is obtained using a platform balance and it comes out to be 9.4 gram. On measuring the mass of this object on an analytical balance, the mass obtained is 9.4213 gram. The mass obtained by an analytical balance is slightly higher than the mass obtained by using a platform balance. Therefore, digit 4 placed after decimal in the measurement by platform balance is uncertain. The uncertainty in the experimental or the calculated values is indicated by mentioning the number of significant figures. Significant figures are meaningful digits which are known with certainty plus one which is estimated or uncertain. The uncertainty is indicated by writing the certain digits and the last uncertain digit. Thus, if we write a result as 11.2 ml, we say the 11 is certain and 2 is uncertain, and the uncertainty would be plus or minus 1 in the last digit. Unless otherwise stated, an uncertainty of plus and minus 1 in the last digit is always understood. There are certain rules for determining the number of significant figures. These are stated below. First, all non-zero digits are significant. For example, in 285 cm, there are 3 significant figures, and in 0.25 ml, there are 2 significant figures. Second, zeros preceding to first non-zero digit are non-significant. Such a zero indicates the position of decimal point. Thus, 0.03 has 1 significant figure and 0.0052 has 2 significant figures. Third, Zeros between two non-zero digits are significant. Thus, 2.005 has four significant figures. Fourth, zeros at the end or right of a number are significant, provided they are on the right side of the decimal point. For example, 0.200 gram has three significant figures. But if otherwise, the terminal zeros are not significant if there is no decimal point. For example, 100 has only one significant figure, but 100 has three significant figures and 100.0 has four significant figures. Such numbers are better represented in scientific notation. We can express the number 100 as 1 into 10 to 2 for one significant figure, 1.0 into 10 to 2 for two significant figures, and 1.00 into 10 to 2 for three significant figures. Fifth, counting the numbers of object. For example, two balls or 20 eggs have infinite significant figures as these are exact numbers and can be represented by writing infinite number of zeros after placing a decimal, that is 2 is equals to 2.000 or 20 is equals to 20.000. If numbers return in scientific notation, all digits are significant. For example, 4.01 into 10 to 2 has 3 significant figures and 8.256 into 10 to minus 3 has 4 significant figures. However, one would always like the results to be precise and accurate. Precision and accuracy are often referred to while we talk about the measurement. Precision refers to the closeness of various measurements for the same quantity. However, accuracy is the agreement of a particular value to the true value of the result. For example, if the true value for a result is 2.00 gram and student A takes two measurements and reports the results as 1.95 gram and 1.93 gram. These values are precise as they are close to each other but are not accurate. Another student B repeats the experiment and obtains 1.94 gram and 2.05 gram as the results for two measurements. These observations are neither precise nor accurate. When the third student C repeats these measurements and reports 2.01 gram and 1.99 gram as the result, these values are both precise and accurate. This can be more clearly understood from the data given in table 1.4. Addition and subtraction of significant figures. The result cannot have more digits to the right of the decimal point than either to the original numbers. 12.11, 18.0, 1.012, 31.122. Here 18.0 has only one digit after the decimal point and the result should be reported only up to one digit after the decimal point, which is 31.1. Multiplication and division of significant figures. In these operations, the result must be reported with no more significant figures as in the measurement with the few significant figures. 2.5 into 1.25 is equals to 3.125. Since 2.5 has two significant figures, the result should not have more than two significant figures, thus it is 3.1. While limiting the result to the required number of significant figures as done in the above mathematical operation, one has to keep in mind the following points for rounding of the numbers. First, if the rightmost digit to be removed is more than 5, the preceding number is increased by 1. For example, 1.386. If we have to remove 6, we have to round it to 1.39. Second, if the rightmost digit to be removed is less than 5, the preceding number is not changed. For example, 4.334, if 4 is to be removed, then the result is rounded up to 4.33. Third point, if the rightmost digit to be removed is 5, then the preceding number is not changed if it is an even number, but it is increased by 1 if it is an odd number. For example, if 6.35 is to be rounded by removing 5, we have to increase 3 to 4, giving 6.4 as the result. However, if 6.25 is to be rounded off, it is rounded off to 6.2. 1.4.3, dimensional analysis. Often while calculating, there is a need to convert units from one system to the other. The method used to accomplish this is called factor label method or unit factor method or dimensional analysis. This is illustrated below. Example, a piece of metal is 3 inch long. What is its length in centimeter? Solution, we know that 1 inch is equals to 2.54 centimeter. From this equivalence, we can write 1 inch upon 2.54 centimeter is equals to 1 is equals to 2.54 centimeter upon 1 inch. Thus, 1 inch upon 2.54 centimeter equals 1, and 2.54 centimeter upon 1 inch also equals 1. Both of these are called unit factors. If some number is multiplied by this unit factors, that is 1, it will not be affected otherwise. Say the 3 inch given above is multiplied by the unit factor. So, 3 inch is equals to 3 inch into 2.54 centimeter upon 1 inch is equals to 3 into 2.54 centimeter is equals to 7.62 centimeter. Now, the unit factor by which multiplication is to be done is that unit factor which gives the desired units, that is the numerator should have that part which is required in the desired result. It should also be noted in the above example that units can be handled just like other numerical part. It can be cancelled, divided, multiplied, squared, etc. Let us study one more example. A jug contains 2 liters of milk. Calculate the volume of the milk in cubic meter. Solution: since 1 liter is equals to 1000 centimeter cube and 1 meter is equals to 100 centimeter, which gives 1 meter upon 100 centimeter is equals to 1 is equals to 100 centimeter upon 1 meter. To get cubic meter from the above unit factors, the first unit factor is taken and it is cubed. 1 meter upon 100 centimeter whole cube is equals to 1 meter cube upon 10 to 6 centimeter cube is equals to 1 cube is equals to 1. Now 2 liter is equals to 2 into 1000 centimeter cube. The above is multiplied by the unit factor. 2 into 1000 centimeter cube into 1 meter cube upon 10 to 6 centimeter cube is equals to 2 meter cube upon 10 to cube in is equals to 2 into 10 to minus 3 meter cube. Example: how many seconds are there in 2 days? Solution: here we know 1 day is equals to 24 hours, or 1 day upon 24 hour is equals to 1 is equals to 24 hour upon 1 day. Then 1 hour is equals to 60 minutes, or 1 hour upon 60 minutes is equals to 1 is equals to 60 minutes upon 1 hour. So for converting 2 days to seconds, that is 2 days to second, the unit factors can be multiplied in series in one step only as follows. 2 day into 24 hour upon 1 day into 60 minutes upon 1 hour into 60 seconds upon 1 minute is equals to 2 into 24 into 60 into 60 seconds is equals to 172800 seconds. 1.5 Laws of chemical combinations. The combination of elements to form compounds is governed by the following 5 basic laws. 1.5.1 Law of conservation of mass. This law was put forth by Antoni Levasseur in 1789. He performed careful experimental studies for combustion reactions and reached to the conclusion that in all physical and chemical changes, there is no net change in mass during the process. Hence, he reached to the conclusion that matter can neither be created nor destroyed. This is called law of conservation of mass. This law formed the basis for several later developments in chemistry. In fact, this was the result of exact measurement of masses of reactants and products and carefully planned experiments performed by Levasseur. 1.5.2 Law of definite proportions. This law was given by a French chemist, Joseph Proust. He stated that a given compound always contains exactly the same proportion of elements by weight. Proust worked with 2 samples of cupric carbonate, one of which was the natural origin and the other was synthetic. He found that the composition of elements present in it was same for both the samples as shown below. Thus, he concluded that irrespective of the source, a given compound always contains same elements combined together in the same proportion by mass. The validity of this law has been confirmed by various experiments. It is sometimes also referred to as law of definite composition. 1.5.3 Law of multiple proportions. This law was proposed by Dalton in 1803. According to this law, if 2 elements can combine to form more than one compound, the masses of one element that combine with a fixed mass of the other element are in the ratio of small whole numbers. For example, hydrogen combines with oxygen to form 2 compounds, namely water and hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen plus oxygen will form water. Hydrogen plus oxygen will form hydrogen peroxide. Here the masses of oxygen, that is 16 gram and 32 gram, which combine with a fixed mass of hydrogen, that is 2 gram, by a simple ratio, that is 16 is to 32 or 1 is to 2. 1.5.4, Galusek's law of gaseous volumes. This law was given by Galusek in 1808. He observed that when gases combine or are produced in a chemical reaction, they do so in a simple ratio by volume, provided all gases are at the same temperature and pressure. Thus, 100 ml of hydrogen combined with 50 ml of oxygen to give 100 ml of water vapor. Hydrogen plus oxygen will form water. Thus, the volume of hydrogen and oxygen which combine, that is 100 ml and 50 ml, bear a simple ratio of 2 is to 1. Galusek's discovery of integer ratio in volume relationship is actually the law of definite proportions by volume. The law of definite proportions stated earlier was with respect to mass. The Galusek's law was explained properly by the work of Avogadro in 1811. 1.5.5, Avogadro's law. In 1811, Avogadro proposed that equal volumes of all gases at the same temperature and pressure should contain equal number of molecules. Avogadro made a distinction between atoms and molecules, which is quite understandable in present times. If we consider again the reaction of hydrogen and oxygen to produce water, we see that two volumes of hydrogen combine with one volume of oxygen to give two volumes of water without leaving any unreacted oxygen. Note that in the figure 1.9, each box contains equal number of molecules. In fact, Avogadro could explain the above result by considering the molecules to be polyatomic. If hydrogen and oxygen were considered as diatomic as recognized now, then the above results are easily understandable. However, Dalton and others believed at that time that atoms of the same kind cannot combine and molecules of oxygen or hydrogen containing two atoms did not exist. Avogadro's proposal was published in the French journal De Physique. In spite of being correct, it did not gain much support. After about 50 years in 1860, the first international conference on chemistry was held at Karlsruhe, Germany to resolve various ideas. At the meeting, Stanislao Cannizzaro presented a sketch of a course of chemical philosophy, which emphasized on the importance of Avogadro's work. 1.6, Dalton's atomic theory. Although the origin of the idea that matter is composed of small indivisible particles called atomium, meaning indivisible, dates back to the time of Democritus, a Greek philosopher, it again started emerging as a result of several experimental studies which led to the laws mentioned above. In 1808, Dalton published a new system of chemical philosophy in which he proposed the following. First, matter consists of indivisible atoms. Second, all atoms of a given element have identical properties, including identical mass. Atoms of different elements differ in mass. Third, compounds are formed when atoms of different elements combine in a fixed ratio. Fourth, chemical reactions involve reorganization of atoms. These are neither created nor destroyed in a chemical reaction. Dalton's theory could explain the laws of chemical combination. However, it could not explain the laws of gaseous volumes. It could not provide the reason for combining of atoms, which was answered later by other scientists. 1.7, atomic and molecular masses. After having some idea about the terms atoms and molecules, it is appropriate here to understand what do we mean by atomic and molecular masses. 1.7.1, atomic mass. The atomic mass or the mass of an atom is actually very, very small because atoms are extremely small. Today we have sophisticated techniques, for example, mass spectrometry for determining the atomic masses fairly accurately. But in the 19th century, scientists could determine the mass of one atom relative to another by experimental means, as has been mentioned earlier. Hydrogen, being the lightest atom, was arbitrarily assigned a mass of 1 without any units, and other elements were assigned masses relative to it. However, the present system of atomic masses is based on carbon 12 as the standard and has been agreed upon in 1961. Here, carbon 12 is one of the isotopes of carbon and can be represented as carbon 12. In this system, carbon 12 is assigned a mass of exactly 12 atomic mass unit, and masses of all other atoms are given relative to this standard. One atomic mass unit is defined as a mass exactly equal to 1/12th of the mass of one carbon, 12th atom. And 1 AMU is equals to 1.66056 into 10 raised to minus 24 gram. Mass of an atom of hydrogen is equals to 1.6736 into 10 raised to minus 24 gram. Thus, in terms of AMU, the mass of hydrogen atom is equals to 1.6736 into 10 raised to minus 24 gram upon 1.66056 into 10 raised to minus 24 gram is equals to 1.0078 AMU is equals to 1.0080 AMU. Similarly, the mass of oxygen 16 atom would be 15.995 AMU. At present, AMU has been replaced by U, which is known as unified mass. When we use atomic masses of elements in calculations, we actually use average atomic masses of elements, which are explained below. 1.7.2 Average atomic mass. Many naturally occurring elements exist as more than one isotope. When we take into account the existence of these isotopes and the relative abundance, in bracket percent occurrence, the average atomic mass of that element can be computed. For example, carbon has the following three isotopes with relative abundance and masses is shown against each of them. From the above data, the average atomic mass of carbon will come out to be 0.98892 into 12U plus 0.01108 into 13.00335U plus 2 into 10 raised to minus 12 into 14.00317U is equals to 12.011U. Similarly, average atomic masses for other elements can be calculated. In the periodic table of elements, the atomic masses mentioned for different elements actually represent their average atomic masses. 1.7.3 Molecular mass. Molecular mass is the sum of atomic masses of the elements present in a molecule. It is obtained by multiplying the atomic mass of each element by the number of its atoms and adding them together. For example, molecular mass of methane, which contains one carbon atom and four hydrogen atoms, can be obtained as follows. Molecular mass of methane, CH4, is equals to 12.011U plus 4 into 1.008U. is equals to 16.043 U. Similarly, molecular mass of water, that is H2O, is equals to 2 into atomic mass of hydrogen plus 1 into atomic mass of oxygen, is equals to 2 into 1.008 U plus 16.00 U is equals to 18.02 unified mass. 1.7.4 Formula mass. Some substances such as sodium chloride do not contain discrete molecules as their constituent units. In such compounds, positive, that is sodium ion, and negative, that is chloride ion, entities are arranged in a three-dimensional structure, as shown in figure 1.10. It may be noted that in sodium chloride, one Na plus ion is surrounded by six Cl minus ion and vice versa. The formula such as NaCl is used to calculate the formula mass instead of molecular mass, as in the solid state sodium chloride does not exist as a single entity. Thus, the formula mass of sodium chloride is atomic mass of sodium plus atomic mass of chlorine is equals to 23.0 U plus 35.5 U is equals to 58.5 U. 1.8 Mole concept and molar masses. Atoms and molecules are extremely small in size and the numbers in even a small amount of any substance is really very large. To handle such large numbers, a unit of convenient magnitude is required. Just as we denote 1 dozen for 12 items, score for 20 items, gross for 144 items, we use the idea of mole to count entities at the microscopic level, that is atoms, molecules, particles, electrons, ions, etc. In SI system, mole was introduced as 7th base quantity for the amount of a substance. The mole symbol mole is the SI unit of amount of substance. 1 mole contains exactly 6.02214076 into 10 raised to 23 eliminatory entities. This number is a fixed numerical value of the Avogadro constant Na when expressed in the unit 1 upon mole and is called the Avogadro number. The amount of substance, symbol small n, of a system is a measure of the number of specified elementary entities. An elementary entity may be an atom, a molecule, an ion, an electron, any other particle or specified group of particles. It may be emphasized that the mole of a substance always contains the same number of entities, no matter what the substance may be. In order to determine this number precisely, the mass of a carbon 12 atom was determined by a mass spectrometer and found to be equal to 1.992648 into 10 to minus 23 gram. Knowing that one mole of carbon weighs 12 gram, the number of atoms in it is equal to 12 gram per mole carbon 12 upon 1.992648 into 10 to minus 23 gram per 12 carbon atom is equals to 6.0221367 into 10 to 23 atoms per mole. This number of entities in one mole is so important that it is given a separate name and symbol. It is known as Avogadro constant or Avogadro number denoted by Na in honor of Amedeo Avogadro. To appreciate the largeness of this number, let us write it with all zeros without using any powers of 10. 6022 1367, then 16 times 0. Hence, so many entities, atoms, molecules or any other particles constitute one mole of a particular substance. We can therefore say that one mole of hydrogen atoms is equals to 6.022 into 10 to 23 atoms. One mole of water molecules is equals to 6.022 into 10 to 23 water molecules. One mole of sodium chloride is equals to 6.022 into 10 to 23 formula units of sodium chloride. Having defined the mole, it is easier to know the mass of one mole of a substance or the constituent entities. The mass of one mole of a substance in grams is called its molar mass. The molar mass in grams is numerically equal to atomic or molecular or formula mass in U. Molar mass of water is equals to 18.02 gram per mole. Molar mass of sodium chloride is equals to 58.5 gram per mole. 1.9% composition. So far, we were dealing with the number of entities present in a given sample. But many a time, information regarding the percentage of a particular element present in a compound is required. Suppose an unknown or new compound is given to you. The first question you would ask is, what is its formula or what are its constituents and in what ratio are they present in the given compound? For known compounds also, such information provides a check whether the given sample contains the same percentage of elements as present in a pure sample. In other words, one can check the purity of a given sample by analyzing this data. Let us understand it by taking the example of water. Since water contains hydrogen and oxygen, the percentage composition of both these elements can be calculated as follows. Mass percent of an element is equals to mass of that element in the compound into 100 divided by molar mass of the compound. Molar mass of water is equals to 18.02 gram. Mass percent of hydrogen is equals to 2 into 1.008 upon 18.02 into 100 is equals to 11.18. Mass percent of oxygen is equals to 16.00 by 18.02 into 100 is equals to 88.79. Let us take one more example. What is the percentage of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen in ethanol? Molecular formula of ethanol is C2H5OH. Molar mass of ethanol is 46.068 gram. Mass percent of carbon is equals to 24.02 gram upon 46.068 gram into 100 is equals to 52.14%. Mass percent of hydrogen is equals to 6.048 gram by 46.068 gram into 100 is equals to 13.13%. Mass percent of oxygen is equals to 16.00 gram by 46.068 gram into 100 is equals to 34.73%. After understanding the calculation of percent of mass, let us now see what information can be obtained from the percent composition data. 1.9.1 empirical formula for molecular formula. An empirical formula represents the simplest whole number ratio of various atoms present in a compound, whereas the molecular formula shows the exact number of different types of atoms present in a molecule of a compound. If the mass percent of various elements present in a compound is known, its empirical formula can be determined. Molecular formula can further be obtained if the molar mass is known. The following example illustrates this sequence. (1.10) Stoichiometry and stoichiometric calculations. The word stoichiometry is derived from two Greek words, stoichion meaning element and metron meaning measure. Stoichiometry thus deals with the calculation of masses, sometimes volumes also, of the reactants and the products involved in a chemical reaction. Before understanding how to calculate the amounts of reactants required or the products produced in a chemical reaction, let us study what information is available from the balanced chemical equation of a given reaction. Let us consider the combustion of methane. A balanced equation for this reaction is as given below. CH4 plus 2O2 will form CO2 plus 2H2O. Here methane and dioxygen are called reactants and carbon dioxide and water are called products. Note that all the reactants and the products are gaseous in the above reaction, and this has been indicated by letter G in the brackets next to its formula. Similarly, in case of solids and liquids, small s in bracket and small l are written respectively. The coefficients 2 for O2 and H2O are called stoichiometric coefficients. Similarly, the coefficient for CH4 and CO2 is 1 in each case. They represent the number of molecules and moles as well taking part in the reaction or formed in the reaction. Thus, according to the above chemical reaction, 1 mole of CH4 reacts with 2 moles of O2 to give 1 mole of CO2 and 2 moles of H2O. 1 molecule of CH4 reacts with 2 molecules of O2 to give 1 molecule of CO2 and 2 molecules of H2O. 22.7 liter of CH4 reacts with 45.4 liter of O2 to give 22.7 liter of CO2 and 45.4 liter of H2O. 16 gram of CH4 reacts with 2 into 32 gram of O2 to give 44 gram of CO2 and 2 into 18 gram of H2O. From this relationship, the given data can be interconverted as follows. Mass upon volume is equals to density. 1.10.1 limiting reagent. Many a time reactions are carried out with the amounts of reactants that are different than the amounts as required by a balanced chemical reaction. In such a situations, one reactant is in more amount than the amount required by balanced chemical reaction. The reactant which is present in the least amount gets consumed after some time, and after that further reaction does not take place whatever be the amount of the other reactant. Hence, the reactant which gets consumed first limits the amount of product formed and is therefore called the limiting reagent. In performing stoichiometric calculations, this aspect is also to be kept in mind. 1.10.2 Reactions in solutions. A majority of reactions in the laboratories are carried out in solutions. Therefore, it is important to understand as how the amount of substance is expressed when it is present in the solution. The concentration of a solution or the amount of substance present in its given volume can be expressed in any of the following ways. First, mass percent or weight percent in bracket W by W percent. Second, mole fraction. Third, molarity. Fourth, molality. Let us now study each one of them in detail. First, mass percent. It is obtained by using the following relation. Mass percent is equals to mass of solute upon mass of solution into 100. Second, mole fraction. It is the ratio of number of moles of a particular component to the total number of moles of the solution. If a substance A dissolves in substance B and the number of moles are Na and Nb respectively, then the mole fractions of A and B are given as mole fraction of A is equals to number of moles of A upon number of moles of solutions is equals to Na upon Na plus Nb. Mole fraction of B is equals to number of moles of B upon number of moles of solution is equals to Nb upon Na plus Nb. Third, molarity. It is the most widely used unit and is denoted by capital M. It is defined as the number of moles of the solute in 1 liter of the solution. Thus, molarity capital M is equals to number of moles of solute upon volume of solution in liters. Suppose we have 1 molar solution of a substance, say NaOH, and we want to prepare a 0.2 molar solution from it. 1 molar NaOH means 1 mole of NaOH present in 1 liter of the solution. For 0.2 molar solution, we required 0.2 moles of NaOH dissolved in 1 liter solution. Hence, for making 0.2 molar solution from 1 molar solution, we have to take that volume of 1 molar NaOH solution which contains 0.2 mole of NaOH and dilute the solution with 1 water to 1 liter Now, how much volume of concentrated NaOH solution be taken which contains 0.2 moles of NaOH can be calculated as follows. If 1 mole is present in 1 liter or 1000 ml solution, then 0.2 mole is present in 1000 ml upon 1 mole into 0.2 mole solution is equals to 200 ml solution. Thus, 200 ml of 1 molar NaOH are taken and enough water is added to dilute it to make it 1 liter. In fact, for such calculations, a general formula M1 into V1 is equals to M2 into V2, where M and V are molarity and volume respectively can be used. In this case, M1 is equal to 0.2 mole, V1 is equal to 1000 ml, and M2 is equals to 1 mole, 1 molar, V2 is to be calculated. Substituting the values in the formula, 0.2 molar into 1000 ml is equals to 1 molar into V2. V2 is equals to 0.2 molar into 1000 ml upon 1 molar is equals to 200 liter. Note that the number of moles of solute was 0.2 into 100 ml and it is remained the same, that is 0.2 even after dilution, as we have changed just the amount of solvent, that is water, and have not done anything with respect to NaOH. But keep in mind the concentration. 4. Molality. It is defined as the number of moles of solute present in 1 kg of solvent. It is denoted by small m. Thus, molality is equals to number of moles of solute upon mass of solvent in kg. Summary. Chemistry as we understand it today is not a very old discipline. People in ancient India already had the knowledge of many scientific phenomena and much before the advent of modern science. They applied the knowledge in various walks of life. The study of chemistry is very important as its domain encompasses every sphere of life. Chemists study the properties and structure of substances and the changes undergone by them. All substances contain matter which can exist in 3 states, solid, liquid, or gas. The constituent particles are held in different ways in these states of matter and they exhibit their characteristic properties. Matter can also be classified into elements, compounds, or mixtures. An element contains particles of only one type, which may be atoms or molecules. The compounds are formed where atoms of 2 or more elements combine in a fixed ratio to each other. Mixtures occur widely and many of the substances present around us are mixtures. When the properties of a substance are studied, measurement is inherent. The quantification of properties requires a system of measurement and units in which the quantities are to be expressed. Many systems of measurement exist, of which the English and metric systems are widely used. The scientific community, however, has agreed to have a uniform and common system throughout the world, which is abbreviated as SI units, that is International System of Units. Since measurements involve recording of data, which are always associated with a certain amount of uncertainty, the proper handling of data obtained by measuring the quantities is very important. The measurements of quantities in chemistry are spread over a wide range of 10⁻³⁶ to 10⁻²³. Hence, a convenient system of expressing the numbers in scientific notation is used. The uncertainty is taken care of by specifying the number of significant figures in which the observations are reported. The dimensional analysis helps to express the measured quantities in different system of units. Hence, it is possible to interconvert the results from one system to units to another. The combination of different atoms is governed by basic laws of chemical combination, this being the law of conservation of mass, law of definite proportions, law of multiple proportions, Galilei's law of gaseous volumes, and Avogadro law. All these laws lead to the Dalton's atomic theory, which states that atoms are building blocks of matter. The atomic mass of an element is expressed relative to carbon-12 isotope of carbon, which is an exact value of 12 U, that is unified mass. Usually, the atomic mass used for an element is the average atomic mass obtained by taking into account the natural abundance of different isotopes of that element. The molecular mass of a molecule is obtained by taking some of the atomic masses of different atoms present in a molecule. The molecular formula can be calculated by determining the mass percent of different elements present in a compound and its molecular mass. The number of atoms, molecules, or any other particles present in a given system are expressed in terms of Avogadro constant, that is 6.022 into 10⁻²³. This is known as 1 mole of the respective particles or entities. chemical reactions represent the chemical changes undergone by different elements and compounds. A balanced chemical equation provides a lot of information. The coefficients indicate the molar ratios and the respective number of particles taking part in a particular reaction. The quantitative study of the reactants required or the products formed is called stoichiometry. Using stoichiometry calculations, the amount of one or more reactants required to produce a particular amount of product can be determined and vice versa. The amount of substance present in a given volume of a solution is expressed in number of ways. For example, mass percent, mole fraction, molarity, and molality.